Okay, now it's my turn. You may stop screen sharing.
All right.
And now it's my turn to
Hey,
screen
could
share.
I? I'm gonna take a really, really fast bathroom break. I'll be back in like 1 minute.
All right, no problem. I will cut the video out, don't worry, it's fine.
All right. I'll be right back. All right, I'm back.
Okay, I'm back. Hello?
Hey.
All right, yeah. I expressed in game my comfort with pizza, so therefore I was just making a pizza. That's what I was doing. All right. So, this is really important right here. Let's go ahead and just
See.
I will not. Okay, I'm gonna mute the sound. Didn't mean to do that. All right. And I have this thing always like active on my thing, so it's gonna look weird in the when we watch it. If you need to rewatch it. But we're gonna start with the early laning phase. So, oh my god, these idiots. Jesus Christ. It's just, I love smurfing in silver due to the fact that I could capitalize on shit like this. So first, when you guys decided to 2v2 right here and it was really risky, I noticed that when you reciprocated the trade, you didn't exhaust the air zero right away. Obviously, you can't see him, but, like, okay, so right here. When he decides to do this, that was a response is to exhaust him so that she doesn't take any more damage because that threatens her life. A second, your
Yeah.
body blocks are pretty much on point. You're probably not thinking about it, but like, now that I put it to your attention, your body blocks They're getting it better, like, for sure. Every now and then, when I was watching your video, it would skip, but it wasn't anything that my brain could process. Like, it wasn't a big deal. Like, oh my god, it just skipped. It's not you lagging. It's just how Skype, like, processes data. I can process, like, what you did in the meantime. If it lags on your end, I'm sorry, but, like, you still won a game. Like, this was solid. Kaboom. This backing up is fine. And you know why, because look at the, remember when we talked about minions? Look at this.
Oh, like, yeah.
No way. Do not fight that. No, 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 no. No shield. You have a pot. It's running. So it won't. You'll just use up the rest of the pot. Then the next one will tick. So it's dangerous. You back up. She goes, ape. And look, look, look. I knew it was going to happen. See? You're only... Yeah, this was... Yeah, you can't... Yeah. So as a response, like, it's gone. You should just, like... When I told you to relinquish it, like, just let it go. It's fine. So next thing that happens is... You know why? If you let it go, right? Look how low Ezreal is. And he has 15 CS and he can't stay any further because he just pushed this entire wave. Due to this, the only possible course of action that he can take... Also, he ran out of mana. He just has to back. So... Because he has to back... He has to buy tier, so he doesn't really get a power spike, but because he has to back, and Vel'Koz just died way before, you know, Ezreal did, that means when you come in, you have the chance to pick him off. You could back yourself and just upgrade the thing, but there's no point. Instead, what the next thing you should do is, you know, go off the Vel'Koz. See, right here, I was like, hey, what is he doing? Look at his level. Your sum's still up. Ignore that. Level. 3 plus 3 is 6. Divide that by 2 is 3 if you take the average, who cares? But 3 is greater than 2. And, you know, mathematically, you're just stronger. So, and you have bigger CC. Like, what the fuck? And the question is, why is he staying? So, as soon as you see him, hook him. Kaboom! Banjo-Kazooie, and then he's done. Just smack him it up. You didn't need to exhaust him, really. The flash was necessary due to the fact that she was just knocked up. And you get the idea, see? So that was free.
Yeah.
But, like, I was just wondering, like, what the fuck is he doing? Because he already died once. Now, like, the more he dies, the more farther and farther he gets behind. So then we get back into lane. This stuff happens. And then, like, you know that his exhaust is... Like, you just gotta stay on top of him. You know that his exhaust is down because he used it... Or no, his exhaust is up because you used yours way later than his. And yours is just about to come up, which means that his is gonna come up sooner. Then you guys get poked under tower. You guys at the back. Where's the part where you get that Mad Life Q? I just want to say that was pretty fucking sick. This was retarded. This guy was just like ape. So right here, alright, so... Here? Yeah, here. Notice his positioning. When you cast it, it's like a Maokai. I don't know if you've ever played Maokai, especially when he did this. When you locked him down and you centered your camera, I realized that this was an opportunity for you just to ult Ezreal.
Oh.
Yes. Now, if you play Maokai, you know how it's a circular, and then it's like a push, a skill shot at the same time, right? And the people around you get knocked up, right? So when you cast it, you're going to knock up the Nautilus no matter what happens, but your goal is to knock out both of them. This way that, look at all this excess amount of damage that she's taking. Look, she takes a lot of damage. But then, like, he DCs or something. But you took a lot of damage, right?
Yeah.
When it comes to your exhaust decisions, just exhaust somebody that... Okay, so they're all threats, right? All of them are a threat. It doesn't matter which one you exhaust. Just throw it on somebody. Of course, you'll get better at timing, like, oh, he's a threat, and I can exhaust him because I'm in range. But you shouldn't, like, hold your exhaust throughout the entire team fight. It's huge. Like it cripples their damage output. This was a hero play that needed to turn around the game. That was pretty good. And then... the whole warding thing. Most of the time, it's just like where you can ward is like if you place it over like this wall. Like if you stand here, you ward over the wall, it's gonna automatically shove it over the wall. Rip. This is hilarious right here. Hold on.
Suicide.
Well, he should never have lost the first dragon in the first place, remember? Like the very first dragon, he lost it because he didn't smite. Remember that at the dragon pit? That was retarded. I would flame him. Can't call yourself a jungler if you don't have smite and do the dragon, unless you like... You also have to know how to secure. You can't prevent the whole risk-averse thing. When it comes to the rotations, like, you have to answer... Like, you realize you had to... Okay, so, If Renekton teleported earlier, like, he would have destroyed that tower sooner. Like, he would pose a threat to your team. But also, like, he either has to make the... Look, so Ezreal answered it. Like, you see what I mean? Like, people answer to these waves. Because there's a big wave. It's a lot of golden EXP. You have to take it. And then, like, and in the long run, if you ran it down mid, right? If you ran it down mid, there was nothing that you can accomplish. Your team hasn't cashed in. So that means you're fighting your... You've cashed in, but your team is not cashed in. Therefore, you're fighting with a weaker team. Second, the time it takes for you to travel there and, like, do quote-unquote something, it's not worth it, because then you can push out that bot lane so that that bot lane doesn't get crashed in on. And you get vision on Dragon, which is hella important. So, putting that into mind, that's why I told you to rotate to those lanes. And then you see what happens later on because of the, like, because look at where your wave is built. And then Renekton has to answer to that, and then it goes backwards, and then he just starts, like, crashing it into the inhibitor, you know? But, you know, he threw it in because that's it. But if you didn't push it out, it would be even worse. You know where that would have ended up, right? That would have ended up, like, that either that inhibitor goes away, or it's at your Nexus turret, man. Like, he would be at your Nexus turret. Therefore, your push would not be valid. Like, your push, like, to be this... Like, he was just barely here. But because I told you to push out that wave earlier, that means that that wave would have crashed even a little bit further. Therefore, either the inhibitor's gone and it's at the Nexus towers, or he takes one Nexus tower, like, straight up. Then it becomes a base race, or you guys, like, make a risk-averse panic play. You know, a risky panic base play. And you don't want that. So I'm glad you won that one. But you need to work on your exhausts. Itemization-wise, you notice that you're spending gold on... Like, I noticed that now because I've told you to. You're spending gold on the right items in the sense that, like, you know what to prioritize. And you're picking it based on how much gold you have. However, when you do have a slot and you cashed in... you don't seem to buy a control ward to make up for your empty inventory because you have spare gold. I understand that, like, there's some parts where it's like you bought the Aegis but you didn't buy the control ward. Like, you had 1200 gold, you bought the Aegis but you didn't buy the control ward. I told you I valued Ruby Sightstone, but it's okay for you not to buy Ruby Sightstone because Aegis also makes you really tanky too. Either way, both items are really beneficial. But because both items are beneficial, like, you obviously choose the more expensive one because, you know, you're always fighting and stuff like that. It's fine either way. It doesn't really matter. But then you still had extra room in your inventory for a control ward, which you should buy. As for warding, just place them a little closer to the objectives because, like, those little edges do matter because, like, if your team didn't get Baron, I think. Your team get Baron? I don't remember. But you can't see it. Because there's wards in there, so, like, it's just important that you get it deep inside. That goes for both sides of the map. Like, if you're blue side or red side, it doesn't matter. And then your ult decisions are more towards peeling, which is great. Very, very great. I was checking your runes and masteries in the middle of the game. Anyway, your ults are very peeling, but also... Because you're the only form of initiation, sometimes if you don't see any room or time to peel and it looks like it's time to fight, a lot of the times this comes down to you looking at the map and where the waves are on both sides of the map are going. For example, if a top lane wave is rolling, that means that somebody has to answer to that on your side or on their side. And right here, a bot lane wave is rolling, so you have to answer to that too. So if you see that Kha'Zix is bottom, 5v4, you should fight. Kha'Zix doesn't have teleport. Just go on him. You know? Or not, sorry, not go on him. Yeah. Go up, force a fight. Look at how many people are on your side. 5v4, numbers wise, you win. And even if you trade one for one, it now becomes a 4v3. Mathematically, you still win. Because 5 is always going to be greater than 4.
True.
This, I don't understand. Like, honestly, they should have just not been there. As for warding, jungle entrances, super huge. When they have buffs like that, there's just two really important points that I told you to ward. You were just there. Not there. Yeah, I think we were traveling. No. So this is a jungle entrance. One of the jungle entrances. Because, like, when they kill Baron, the first thing that they're going to do if they don't back to base immediately is go through this right here. Right? Makes sense, right?
Yeah.
They just go through there. Second, the other one is where Lee Sin is standing. You know that little entrance next to the Raptors? That's the other option. Because then these are called rotational entrances, too. Because, like, when they rotate, they have to cross that area. From mid. So warding it means that, oh, this is their move. And also, they also like to cheese the bush too, so that you can avert that, like, protect your team, you know. And with Baron, like, it's always imperative to have things warded because wards are very critical to winning. See, like, that bush should have been warded right there. Now Kha'Zix has control of it. I was, like, kind of confused. And then I assume that half the time you're gonna hook to like the thing is with your hooks, obviously some of them are fucking amazing, and then some of them are just like they hit the wall or they like fall flat. So that's a little inconsistency factor. Right here, I thought you were gonna hook right away or just stop the fucking Kha'Zix. You have to hit him or something. Just cast spells, and then you got the ult off. That's fine. You should have just let it go. Because he's locked for that brief second. Now you have to push mid, but sometimes you don't. You hook the minion instead. Like think about which one's more free. If you auto them, it's free. Like they can't move. Then you hook them immediately after you auto them. You can be risky and throw the hook, sure. Because that'll force them to flash or sidestep to the left or right, but you could also be in range and just auto them. I noticed that you also haven't done a flash force. Oh, you actually have, but like you haven't done a flash hook to initiate, which is really crazy, but like also can be really good. And when it comes to like final team fights like this, yeah, you can do that. Otherwise, it's fine if you don't. Another thing is consider final item to be like a GA or a Banshee's Veil, something really tanky. You don't need 40% CDR. You should really not go for 40% CDR in Nautilus. You don't need the 40% CDR. You just need to be like utility and then tank at the same time. So the final item would have to be something like ZZ Rot Portal. That's pretty good. Banshee's Veil, defense. Randuin's Omen. Frozen Heart if you have to build a Frozen Heart. You know what I mean? Okay.
So like I'm trying to I really have no idea. I need to find myself a champion that I can just kind of spam games and like normals, kind of the way I did with Janna. Because I need to get comfortable with someone on that level to where I could just climb. And I you did say Morgana and Karma.
Yes, Morgana and Karma. If you want to, you can do a normal and just practice that champion as you speak right now. If you
Okay.
wanted
Yeah. I really, man, I'm so bad at Morgana. I don't know why I'm so bad at her.
Oh,
what is
wait.
it?
I never talked to your. I never spoke to you about your Blitzcrank. Did you still want to do a review on the Blitzcrank? Because there is something that I have to tell you on the Blitzcrank. It's called the psychological factor. You don't have to walk up and throw the
Really?
hook. Like, remember that you exist and people are scared of you. Because you have a hook. So if you don't throw it and you walk up to them and just scare the shit out of them, they don't know what to do. You know, they start attempting to juke it for no reason, and you don't even have to throw it out. Just walk up to them and eat them. Then they're in the air, then they flash, and then you just hook them after they flash.
The only thing about Blitz, my games, when I play this game, it's either a hit or miss. It's not just with Blitz, it's with most champions, but it's kind of more apparent, not apparent, it's more like noticeable with Blitz because so I have some games where I'm just doing so good. Like one game, I've never done this before, I actually like predicted a flash and got like an
Sick.
amazing hook.
Yeah.
And then there's games where I freaking miss every single one and I'm basically useless. But the thing is, that's the reason why I don't like playing Blitz. When I'm playing Janna or someone else, I have so much utility. I don't have like one ability that I have to rely on. I have so many other things I can do, you know, if I'm not 100%. Like I have shields and stuff like that. When I'm Blitz, I can't really, I don't have a
Right,
lot of
right.
peel.
Well, your goal is when you pick Blitz, your goal isn't to peel, obviously. It's your goal is to pick people off. I pick supports based on my team composition. Most of the time, it's either Janna or Karma.
I'm
Or
also
Morgana.
trying to get used to his hitboxes because I see people can like
Land the most bullshit
throw it
hooks.
through, yeah, through minions too. I can't do that.
Yeah.
Every time I try, it's like I don't really understand the hitboxes. I know the minion hitboxes are supposed to be smaller, but every time I think I see an opening, it's always wrong.
When people move, you don't try to predict it. You can either the way you land skill shots is you just shoot it where they are. You either force them to dodge it or they don't dodge it. But factor in travel time.
Yeah, definitely. I literally have a habit to try to predict.
Yeah.
Like, okay, where
No,
are they going to
it
be?
happens. It's a muscle memory that you can't force to change. The way I do it is I predict their predictions and I miss a lot of my skill shots, but like when I land the critical ones, it's insane. And people are like, "What the fuck is that?" And I'm like, "Yeah." But like it either happens or it doesn't. There's no there it, you have a 50-50 chance of landing each and every single skill shot, but when you're on point, you're on point. Like that's just how it is. In terms of itemization, he did fine that game. For the most part, you understand where my build is coming from, like the whole utility use value of Ruby Sightstone. Ruby Sightstone is just really good, but if you're behind, you should just build Eye of the Equinox, to be honest. That's if you're behind, because like you just can't afford to purchase anything else. But if you, it kind of depends on how you value things. Like a lot of people will, what the fuck? I said Nautilus support, thank you. A lot of people value Eye of the Equinox, but I value this right here, Ruby Sightstone. See, it's like you have a 50% win rate with this. You have a higher win rate with this, and just as many games. Like it's like you kind of, what do you value, to be honest? Like it's just kind of, yeah. This is there. I would never build Sunfire Cape on support. It's not worth it. Utility aspect: Randoman's Omens gives better stats, 60 armor, reduces 10% damage from crits from 80 carries. Huge. Why the fuck would I get Sunfire Cape when it costs the same? Like the fuck? Dead Man's Plate is for picks. I'd understand that. This is a very, very solid straight up KDA right here. Like, it's pretty good. what else is there? If you want to, you can just jump into another game and play that, whether it be ranked or not ranked. I don't mind. This would be our third hour. Otherwise, you can if you want to like take a break or something or rest and talk more about conceptual stuff, that's fine too. And then like theories and stuff like that or questions, that's no big deal. I listen to the champions because they're not mechanically intensive champions and focus more on your knowledge of the game. Which is the most important part in learning how to climb in the first place. Since you've already agreed with that, that's no big deal.
Yeah.
And then, with that being said, you can also pick, if you feel like you can pick up Zyra too. She's not super mechanically intensive, she's a bully, and you already know that through personal experience.
Yes. I've never actually played her before.
She has skill she has a lot of skill shots, so she's fairly difficult. She won't just be like you can pick her up right away, but if you did want to grind out normals, you may go ahead and just pick her up like that. When it comes for me learning new champions, sometimes I just throw it up in ranked or go up on a smurf. At least then the players are serious, so I have a challenge.
I think it would be better for me to start grinding like you said, I don't know, either Morgana or Karma. I'm better with Karma, but Morgana is a really good champion. I'm just so bad at her.
Morgana is more of like, a very psychological champion, like I said. You don't even have to throw the binding. Instead, you just walk up, ult them, and then they can't do anything in response to your ult. And then they just get killed because they're stunned, and then you land the binding, and then they're locked for like 20 seconds. And it's just like, what the hell?
And her shield is so useful.
Correct. It can save.
It's amazing.
It's basically like a counter to Blitzcrank because you can't pull them if they're...
Yeah,
very, very good champion. Put that in your
like. Will that counter like anything? Like would that'll counter a Nautilus ulti, right?
Yes, it just block. You just don't get knocked up, and it just goes on.
Cog blocks everything.
Yes, it just doesn't block the physical damage aspect. For example, if you're playing against a Lee Sin, if you're playing against a Lee Sin, right, he will kick you, and you will still take the physical damage, but you will not get knocked back.
Okay.
That makes sense, right? That explanation kind of makes sense. It's like basically the same concept. It just looks fucking hilarious. You're just like, you just kicked my face, but I don't move. And normally you'd move, but you don't move, so it just looks so funny. So that's something you can consider. Morgana, Karma, because Karma carries by the poke. Like you basically just pew 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 pew. Obviously, mana management is super important when it comes to playing the game. Because you have to be able to manage your mana very efficiently when it comes to playing Karma. She relies solely on the aspect of utilizing her mana to its fullest potential by utilizing every single spell in every aspect, from different angles of spells, creativity. Limiting your usage of certain spells in order to gain an advantage, for example. There are a lot of tricks with Karma that even I still don't know what to do. I just use her because I know how to play utility style champions.
So
as for your other champions, you also can consider Annie support and Sona support. These aren't very brain like intensive mechanical champions. It's fine to use these champions. I play
Annie definitely when I'm mid. I know because mid is my second role and I just play Annie and it's pretty usually an easy lane.
Nothing wrong with that. Nothing wrong with that at all. Best champion for me. Correct.
Yeah. But With support, my three best supports are Janna, Sona, and Nautilus. So I could play Sona. It's just, I don't know. Like, I play Sona when I'm up against like Poke that I can just heal right back up, or she's really fun against Squishies because I can just when I spawn, like when the game first starts, I instantly start Q and I use it twice before we leave.
Right, because that then way, as soon as you get into the lane, you Q auto them and it's an instant Poke and proc Thunderlords. Yep.
Yeah, exactly. So that's the thing I love about Sona. But when I'm against like Blitzcrank or Thresh and they just nail me good early game, I kind of become kind of useless. But that doesn't happen too often.
If you can blind pick a support, Nautilus and Janna are your go-tos then. Because
Nautilus and Janna.
Yeah, because like the way you play Nautilus, it seems like it's really really comfortable as a pick for you. And the way you play Janna, the only thing you have to improve on is just your choices. Like most of the time, I can literally see the mistakes because we play the same role. But I played every single role, so that's why it's like it's like I'm able to see all these things. And it's not like I'm picking like all these mistakes, but like the thing is, when you're up against a Smurf, you never know if you're up against a Smurf, but you'll see mistakes that the opponents make. Like, you saw that Vel'Koz. I felt like you were hesitant. Then I told you, just kill this guy. And then you just slaughtered him and then, like, snowballed the game. I'm like, you see how easy this game is? Like, you know what I mean? Like, you noticed that he was out of position, right?
Yeah.
It's easy. It's very easy to tell when, like, that's what the role of supporting is. You set up kills for your laner. Like, your fucking MF went off, dude. 19 kills? Like, come on. Like, she's retarded in the sense that she goes in, I know Nautilus, you just pushed that lane, but I'm gonna go check it myself. Oh, hey, how's your day going? And then he dies. Like, are you daft, dude? Like, are you serious then? Like, he didn't need to do that. It was so unnecessary. God, that bothers me so much. But, ward coverage is just, you just need to understand the wards. Like, you're constantly going to be rewarding as a support, and I don't see you do it as much. Because, like, as you're traveling, you should be, like, warding along the way where we think enemies might be or enemies might cross to contest an objective such as blue buff, red buff.
I think it's partly, like, a mental thing with me because when I'm playing Janna, I mean, it depends, but usually when I'm playing Janna, I'm kind of... I think it's the fact that I'm really fast because of my W's passive, and I'm not really worried about trying to get picks like I am with Nautilus, so... I'm more likely to go reward and run around warding with Janna. Because I don't think about it as much.
Yeah.
With, like, Blitz.
Yes. But you can't enter the mentality like that because it's not about being like the champion. It's about being the player. Like, for example, like when I'm playing a mid laner champion like Victor, Ahri, or Swain, I play Victor, Ahri, Swain, Ori, Cassiopeia, Kassadin, Karma mid, Lulu mid, Morgana mid. I play a lot of mid lane champions. It's my knowledge of mid lane that factors in. Like my playstyle will change because of the champion's kit, but my style of mid lane of aggression and like calculated hyper aggression will never change. The way I play it is I always get camped, so therefore I end up buying a lot more wards than I need to because I know I'm gonna get camped because of the way I play. Literally, I'm Asian Hashinshin if you watch pros and stuff like that. Like I get camped more than at this point, I go to the grocery store and I looked at. I tell my friends like, "Hey, look right here, I need this." And he's like, "Oh, Daniel, you're getting camped again, aren't you?" I'm like, "Yeah." Like I point to fucking graham crackers. I point to fucking what's my other thing to figure? Oh, I pointed to some marshmallows recently when I was at Food for Less. I was like, "Hey," because I'm getting camped so much. But
yeah,
your role as a laner is fine. I'm comfortable with watching you lane, but it's just your mid-game decision-making that's huge. So, one thing that I also didn't notice is that, like, okay, so your rotation was pretty good, but, like, there are some times when you can just ditch your lane. Like, let's say your AD carry is, like, sometimes you ask me, like, if you can wait so you can make your next move. That is fine. Sometimes it's okay to wait. But if you have a Sight Stone in your inventory, sometimes it's okay for you to just leave the lane, just go out warding, like, a choke or checking out Dragon. This game, it wasn't as necessary because they had a fucking Kha'Zix. Kha'Zix can't really solo Drake, so therefore not necessary. But you do have to be aware of Kha'Zix ganks. And then another thing you have to be aware of is the fact that their laners can teleport, so you always have to be, I mean, you always have to be careful of, like, the teleport threat, so that's where the sweeper comes in, so that's no big deal. As for refillable plot, I mean, over here, I didn't really call you out on it, but, like, it's just, because you already bought it, it's fine, because, like, that instance, it was useful, but that was, like, only one time. After that, like, you notice, like, I never said any, like, you never bought any more pots, like, it wasn't really necessary. So having a refillable pot in your inventory just means that, like, obviously the slot in your inventory is going to be taken up, so you wouldn't have a lot of room for control wards, but that's a sacrifice, because then, like, you can just, eventually you'll just fucking sell the refillable pot if you really value control wards, which I do. And then, when you start roaming and shit on Nautilus, you can come by and just auto-attack the mid laner, like Cassiopeia, especially when she doesn't have Flash or Ghost, and then you just lock them down, and then your mid laner assassinates the guy. It's pretty straightforward, because Nautilus can do that kind of shit, because he has that ability. And then the next thing is, like, if you pick up more Nautilus, because I'm liking the way you're playing Nautilus right now, it's pretty straightforward. Just, you know, you obviously just work on your hooks, you work on your exhaust, you work on your decisions of ulti. Your ulti's of peeling versus your ulti's of, like, you gotta think, because, like, this is retarded, but at the same time, it's very smart at the same time, and it's so obvious. Like, you think I'm, like, half retarded or something when I say this, but I never thought that Lee Sin's ulti was used to deal damage. Like, Lee Sin's ulti deals damage. That sounds weird, right? But you know it does damage. It's just, I never cheated.
I wouldn't have thought of that either. Like,
you
think, I just think of it as
a knockback, right?
Screw me over, not to, like.
Yeah, I wouldn't think, because what I see is, I was watching a challenger jungler play Lee Sin, because he's a Zac one trick. He's like, this is my first time picking up Lee Sin. He presses R to execute people rather than to knock them back into his team comp and decimate them. And I was like, oh my god, I forgot it could do that. I forgot it does damage. That sounds really, really stupid. But the thing is, he abuses that. He just walks around, he ward hops, Q, RQs. Ward hops, she's low. She just presses R and then he dies. I'm like, oh my god, it does damage. I totally forgot it does damage. And that is of utmost importance, because, like, you should be creating your spells, like the way Lee Sin players work is, I made a play recently. So, where's the game? Please tell me it's still here. Yes. It's right here. Not this. Is it this one? Is it this one? Was it this one? I died for it. It was my death. Yeah, right here. You can see it, right?
Yeah, I can see it.
So I land the Q, but I get stunned by Syndra because I can't see her. I want that kill. Obviously, I'm gonna. It's 15-0, dude. I'm literally destroying this game. It was a normal. I was just having fun. Look, I can't reach her. I don't have flash. I have to do something. Alright, peace. I have no W anymore. And then I walk back into tower range and kill myself. But you see what I mean by creativity, right? Like, I think. I just start thinking about, like, different, like, aspects and stuff like that. So they're like, you would never think, like, oh, it's. Warhop is a gap closer to safety, right, but also can be used aggressively. Treat that with your ultimate. It can be used to peel defensively, initiate offensively, or, in your situation, be used as a linear skill shot to disable multiple targets. That's why I was like, oh, you should have used the ultimate on Ezreal that I bot lane. You would have disabled two people, prevented MF from using a heal, or delayed the MF using her heal. More important to delay it, because she might heal you, but, like, use it really nicely. But you get the idea, right? Like, it's very important that you use your ultimates. Like you're not gonna come up with creativity things like upon the spot. Like, it's not just gonna come up with the fly. But, like, when you start thinking about it and putting it into practice, like, oh dude, that's so cool. Like, I started ward hopping more on Lee Sin as the seasons went by, because I wasn't very good at Lee Sin when I started. I was like bronze Lee, and every season I would just improve one by one in terms of elo on Lee. It's hilarious. But I would start thinking about things more creatively. I would start using, like, my spells in different manners in psychological aspects, in non-psychological aspects, using my spells for damage, because that's what it does. But, like, you get the idea.
Right.
So, with Nautilus, the only thing I could say aside from, like, using your fucking Q to look the fucking wall, like, gap close. That was hilarious. I can't believe that didn't work out. But that's not the point. It's your ultimate. use it as a linear... Don't think about it just as a point-and-click ult to initiate. Remember that it cannot miss. And on the way, if you see people lined up for it, kaboom, it's a multi-man skill shot that can disable and set up a, you know, your Yasuo. Set up a Yasuo for a beautiful ulti to continue to engage. You had an opportunity to ult a few times, or sorry, not ult a few times, hook a few times, but you didn't take them. But that's okay, you know, like your team was able to come back. Exhausting is very important. You never want to, like, die with exhaust. You want to just, fuck it, just drop it on somebody. It doesn't matter who, just try your best, like, to exhaust the target. So that's really important. It's because, I can't do another. I don't think I can do another session because I have to leave very soon. That's why. So that's why I'm going over conceptual stuff with you because this is very important to your advancement as a player too. Thinking about these things because that's because you remember coaching isn't like freeload, like getting carried like duo queue or anything like that. You know, coaching is more of like implementing things that you wouldn't have seen like before, creative things that have never been seen before in your mind, and putting them into practice because that's how it works. Like again, I never realized that like Lee Sin ulti was used for damage. Started winning 7 more games because I just started pressing R and killing people. I never realized that Warthop should be used as an offensive and defensive manner rather than just as a gap closer, like to chain abilities or something. I started winning more games on Lee. It's like wow, what is this? Huh. And it's very very important. On Janna, the only thing I can advise you on is your itemization, because that's one of the important things. Aside from that, your juking abilities are completely fine. Obviously, you're going to have to get better at juking. Like, every single player in the world has to, you know, get better at juking, flashing, and stuff like that. Don't, and for the love of heaven, don't greed your flash. Don't greed your flash. Like, don't hold on to it just because you don't think you're about to get hit by a skill shot.
Yeah.
I greeted my flash in a low elo game, and I was so disappointed in myself. I was like, my god, I should have lived there. I was so frustrated that I had the audacity to just hold on to my flash. Like, I knew the enemy had an ulti on Varus. And I knew it was like, okay, if it comes and hits me, I die. All I have to do is flash it. It came out, and I was like, wait. I'm like, am I high or something? That was my fault. And then I died as a result, and it was really, really, really sad because I could have reacted to it better. And as for skill shots, like, you don't have really, like, your champion pool doesn't really rely on landing skill shots except for Morgana, but Morgana's skill shot is really fucking wide. Remember that the closer you get to your target, the harder it is for them to dodge the skill shot. Would you agree?
I would.
Yeah, because you're literally on top of them, right?
Yeah,
how do I dodge? They have to dodge by flashing the shit out of it.
And the only way to, like, miss that is, like, if you're really close to Yasuo when he dashes over you and you
just like shoot it over the wall. Of course but you understand the aspect of what I'm telling you. So with the psychological champions, with Nautilus, hence why I say don't try to hook first. Sometimes I told you not to hook, you tried it anyway and you landed it, that's great. But like, what you can do instead is just walk up and auto them, then you can't miss. Or you walk up really close to them and hook them because it's harder for them to dodge it. Then you auto them immediately. Then you E them. You don't want to E them before you auto them. You want to auto them, then you E them, because then more ticks of your E get off, which means more damage. And of course, bigger slow or longer slow, because as they get hit by the stacks, it refreshes the slow. So it's slowed for longer.
Oh, really?
Yeah, because every time they get hit by it, they get slowed. It's the same thing as Jace Gate. When Jace gates, the longer you stand in it, like the longer you travel through it, the more you the longer the duration is for the thing. So that's a benefit to you.
Yeah, I think I have to work on remembering that. Like, cause when I play Blitz, I know it's smarter to run up with W, knock them up, and then grab them.
Yes.
However, I'm always hesitant to do that. Maybe it's because I'm used to playing passively, like Janna. I'm afraid just to like take all that damage for nothing, and then I'm like, I just bail out and back out, and they just got free damage off because I didn't commit.
That's another thing. Every champion, you can't play the same champion like the same. You can't play every champion the same playstyle. The reason why I only play mages is because I'm not mechanically proficient enough to play Zed or Yasuo or Talon. Like, legitimately serious, I cannot play melee ADs. I just suck.
Yeah, I've never played any of those.
Yeah,
ever.
Don't stay away from them. I'm glad you stay away from them because they're not for anybody until plat, maybe like high plat, because mechanically they're good. People are pretty good at plat, like mechanically.
That's also the reason why I'm not gonna play Thresh, because I love Thresh so much, and I'm trying to get good at him in normals, but man, they're so bad.
Okay,
this,
so the thing with Thresh is there are dimensions for how a support plays. First dimension, one-dimensional supports. They only have one role, and it's in one area. Janna is a one-dimensional support. Do you understand why?
Because all she's capable of doing is peeling.
Yes, exactly. You're not going to expect the Janna to jump in the back line and fuck shit up. Leona is a two-dimensional support. Or, I'm sorry, dive the enemy front line and start fucking shit up. No, you can't do that, no. Leona is a two-dimensional support. She can go in the front line and tank and, like, you know, initiate and stuff and lock someone down. But at the same time, she could be defending in the back line. Correct?
Yeah.
But she can't do both at the same time. She cannot do both. Like, she can't be in the front line and defending the back line simultaneously. Only one champion can be doing both at the same time. And that's Thresh. He is a three-dimensional support. He can... The reason why he can defend the backline is due to his lantern usage, as well as his flay and his hook and his box. He can set up defensive box in the center, and then just play very, very mid-centric, like in the center of the team fights, and then do whatever it takes to protect both AD carry, and at the same time, like his flay goes in two directions. His hook goes in one direction, obviously, but you get the idea, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So that's another benefit. Yes, you can be, but that's the way the dimensions work. Every support's either one or two dimensions, except for Thresh, it's three dimensions. Bard, for example, is two dimensional. He can either go into the front line and start being a stun bot, and he can also like defend the back line, but he can't be do both. But you can consider his ultimate as like one of those tools. I have a Thresh montage. Like you can see, like how my backwards flays are really important to landing. Like the hardest part is the reverse flay. Like I always initiate with the reverse flay rather than a hook. I try not to hook. I have it at low quality because of my internet bandwidth, but I can upgrade it at higher quality, real quick.
So, quick question. And I just thought of this because I just saw you playing Thresh. But how do I explain it? For like over 2 years, I played. I didn't use QuickCast ever. I never even knew what it was.
Yeah.
And then I found out about it, and I found out how it's like. You know, it's way more like efficient because you can. It just saves time. Like the time it takes for you to click an ability, aim it, and click it again. It's just waste time. So ever since then, I couldn't really handle QuickCast, so I put on QuickCast with indicators for like a really long time. And just like a few months ago, I took it off, and I'm used to it now. I'm
just QuickCasting.
I'm completely used to only QuickCasting. Is there ever a time where you would prefer QuickCast with indicators? Is there ever a time where you would use that? Like to see the max range of a Thresh hook or something.
So what
like
I do
that?
Is I don't even use QuickCast with indicators. Like you see, okay, so look right here, watch. See, I hook that was a QuickCast, and then I flayed. Yeah. That was just straight up QuickCast. But then as I'm doing something, look, hold on, you'll see it in just a second. This is the most obvious part of it right here. You saw me QuickCast everything, but then why do you see this right here? Why does this happen? Right?
Yeah. How the heck? How do you do that?
Yeah. So So I quickcast everything, but I binded regular cast to a different key to check range. So I learned this by reading an article off of this player called on Cloud9. His name is Meteos. You know him, right? So Meteos, what he does is he's just a jungler. He plays Lee Sin. So when he was learning how to play Lee Sin jungle, he wanted to, because like you always underestimate hitboxes, but you always want to check. Look at the range of this. This isn't supposed to connect. I just threw it out there anyway. And it connected. I was like, alright, that's cool too. But basically what I would do is I would bind my Q to G for regular cast. So I check my abilities with G. If I don't, like I still smart cast everything. But if I need to check my abilities, like my Morgana binding or my my range of my shield, G and C are my go-to key buttons for it. So I just bind it to whatever I find comfortable. I don't bind W or R. Because I don't really have any extra spots on my keyboard that I can touch really quick. Because like if you do GQ, that's two separate fingers. If you do CE, again, that's two separate fingers. But I can't do ZW or anything like that. Because like I need a lot of my because I use X, V, and T for my active items. 1, 2, 3, 4, X, V, and T. I don't use 5 and 6, but that's too far. You know what I mean? It has to be within your fingers range. So like it's all based on comfort for me. And at the same time, most of the time I check my flay only if it's like. I need to check my flay. And at that point, I checked my flay. It wasn't supposed to land, and it landed. Like, I'm pissed at that because that's bullshit.
It must have just caught the edge of the hitbox.
Oh, yeah, and then Callista, this one was hilarious. Callista jukes to the right, so I shoot the hook to the right. Like, look at my mouse. You see where my mouse is, right?
Yeah.
I either miss it or I land it. And I landed it, and that was funny. I was like, hey, wow. I predicted it. So you can come up to predicting people's movements when it comes to throwing out skill shots. Because, like, in higher elo, it's really obvious. But players like Doublelift, who I've faced in lane before, that's literally impossible to predict. He jukes both ways at inconsistent patterns. There's nothing you could do about it. You have to point and click him to death. He's really fucking good. Like, 80 carries in high elo or scripters, like, they just juke everything. It's really hard.
Man. So...
Yeah, I bind G and C. Q to G and E to C. This way, I can check my abilities radiuses or widths or whatever.
I'm going into like just a custom game so I can set that up.
Yeah, yeah.
That's extremely useful. There's been so many times
casting with indicator frustrates me because if I want to just check a range of a spell, I don't want to cast the fucking spell. That's the most important part. Then like this is the hardest thing to do: a flash reverse play, because you have to move your mouse in two different directions. You know,
so you'll mess it up. Oh yeah. Screw that up every time.
Yeah, that's why. Oh yeah, and then of course, yeah, you'll get used to like playing Thresh. Like eventually, like I just use my knowledge of just practicing Thresh. And then this was the Reddit play right here. I was aiming for Caitlyn. I pinged Caitlyn, and then I aimed my hook to where Caitlyn wasn't even gonna be because I assumed she was gonna juke back. And instead, I missed the hook and I landed on a Blitzcrank. Ooh. And then I got a double play. Nice. And I was just like, "Are you fucking serious, dude?"
Like, okay, so how do I do it? Like
hotkeys?
How do I bind like Q to G?
You don't do, because... Okay, so screen share me real quick. Let me turn off my screen share. Where are you? Okay, there you are. There you are. Okay, so oh my gosh, the map, beautiful. All right, escape. Back to the thing. Go down. And then abilities and summoner spells. Yep, changes that to G.
Oh, shift Q, that's weird. Why is it? Okay.
And then change the shift E to C. I never use shift. I don't ever waste my time with that. Okay, yeah. Press OK.
So spell, that's my E, right?
Press OK, yep. So G, and you'll just check the range. Then click. Like click with your left mouse, and it'll fire the skill shot like a normal skill shot. Makes sense, right?
Oh. Yeah.
It's as if you literally regular cast it, but sometimes I don't do that. You know, sometimes I use G to check the range, then press Q to fire it.
Yeah, that's what I actually did the first time.
Yeah.
Yeah, what I've been doing this, I had no idea like I could do that because. For the longest time, I would do this, right? Let's say I'm going to go for, like, a dragon steel or something like that.
Yeah.
Pretend this here is the wall, right? Yeah. I'm walking up to the wall, and I'm like, okay. And I put my mouse down here.
Yeah, okay, I know what you mean.
And sometimes I'm like this. I'm like, crap, I can't
I do that, so too. No, I get it. It's because when I have my ultimate, and I remember how I said I don't bind it to anything, so I do that when I do it with my ultimate. It just looks so ugly.
Okay. Well, that's extremely useful. Yes. So, now my only... I don't know if this is like... This is probably something that nobody could ever answer, probably. But, when it comes to maining, like, a champion, like, finding that one champion that you can just be so comfortable with, honestly, I have no idea how that became... like Janna for me. Like I think what happened was I just tried her because I saw someone made like a troll video from like season 2 or 3, like a really crappy video, like how Janna is the best support in the game, but it was like a troll video, like it was a joke, it was like really funny. And I was like, oh, that's kind of funny. So I tried her and I kind of liked her, but I hated the way she looked and like felt. And then
seasons, it was fucking terrible. Like she sounded like she was retarded or some shit. And I was like, my god, this is
fucking
ridiculous.
I was like, sometimes I think it's a mental thing. Like I can't freaking play certain champions. So I got that skin for her, the forecast Janna, and it made everything completely different. And now, And it made me like love her for some reason, and that's how I ended up maining her. I don't know, it's kind of weird. So, and every other champion that I ever play, I get to the point where I'm like decent with them, but never as good as I am with Janna. Like, I can do like anything with Janna.
Right.
Like, I'm so confident in every little thing that I could do. Like, I don't have to think, like, to shield someone. I just do it, like, instinctively, when I have to. When I'm playing other champs, like, when I'm playing Nautilus, I don't even think about using W to shield myself. I forget about it.
It's also an auto-attack reset. I don't know if you know that either, but, like, it really just increases your DPS, which we don't really mind, but that's more of a Nautilus top thing. But you auto, and then you W, and then you auto again, and it just increases, like, your damage output.
I can play Janna in my sleep.
Mm-hmm. That's everyone can, yeah. Or, for the most part, everyone can, but they really can't, because, like, there's a lot of mistakes that, like, can be seen.
Right. So, like, I grind a Thresh, right, in normals, because I know that if I can get so good at Thresh and get to the point of comfort that I am with Janna, to where I can just confidently throw out a hook, you know, I can use Flay without screwing up every time,
mm-hmm.
that I could then take him into ranked and just freaking climb as far as, you know.
Right.
But I couldn't do it. I played him so many times. I got, like, the level 4 mastery and, like 2 days. Like, I played him nonstop, and I understand how he works now, but I'm not really that good with him still.
Right.
And the reason why I'm like mentioning this is because I want to get good with someone who can help me carry, and I'm going to bring up Karma again, because I know that if I can get good enough with her, she's a really good champion to carry with, like you said. So
decision making is one of the most important parts about being like a high elo player, because we're all given, like, I was given the same champion as you. I've given the same runes, same masteries. What makes me a better, like, what? Why am I higher than you in the ladder, you know? Like,
right.
That's the same thing. I'm like, I don't understand. Like, oh, like, we have the same champions. I'm playing, like, what's wrong? Well, at that point, it's just decision-making. Like, my choices, every single one of the things I told you to do. You notice that you just, like, straight up just won that Nautilus game. I was only, like, barking, like, I was only, like yelling commands. Like, one at a time, but, like, you saw when you see what I saw, I was like, hey, here's an opportunity right here. You saw it, too, but, like, you weren't always aware of it. Like, sometimes, yeah. I don't know if you would have killed that Vel'Koz early. I don't know if you would have checked the entrances properly, et cetera, but that's what I would have done, you know? And then, of course, like, the Flash Ezreal thing, I would not have done that. I was like, hell no. I would just straight up bail. Yeah, like, you know what I mean? Like, of course, every little thing counts.
I get impulsive. Yeah, definitely.
Every little thing counts, and it does matter. Like I said, I nitpick a lot on micro stuff, because like that, you can't afford to make those kinds of mistakes. It's very, very imperative that you don't make those, right. Like, really small mistakes. Like, for example, like, you don't even know if, like, if you look at the map, like, you didn't see if there's any junglers anywhere. What if mid was Mia? So if someone came in and you just flash forward, you can't really get out. You know?
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
GG.
always respect the jungler until he reveals himself. You know what I
mean? Yeah.
So that's really, really, really
so
important.
I know one thing that I notice every single time, whenever I lose a lane, every single time, it was because usually 99% of the time it's because they were more aggressive and obviously won the trades. Like, whenever I'm doing bad and I'm tilting, it's because they're so aggressive. Like, let's say they have a Zyra and she keeps freaking rooting me.
Yeah.
And I'm getting poked. They're being aggressive. That's what makes a lane win. I mean, obviously you have to do it, like, you have to know how to do it and not get out traded. But
yeah.
I think the issue with Janna is she's so passive that you don't really have many opportunities unless someone's like stupid, right? Let's say like they have an Ashe, I don't know, it doesn't matter, and yep. they're kind of near your tower and they're way out of position, you
yep.
can kind of slower flash and ultra into your tower and
correct.
Get a free kill.
Yep, yep.
I do
yep.
that all the time. I do it all the time.
It's hilarious. It's hilarious. Yep.
Yeah. So that's the only opportunity, that's the only thing Janna could do that's aggressive. So
yes.
It's hard to carry with that.
Yes.
But she's
you are 100% reliant. It is stated by every single high elo player. Every one of them, you will ask, like, oh, what do you think about Janna? Bad, because she is 100% reliant on the AD carry. Like, can you solo carry a lane? Never. But you.
It's fun though. Like, when I'm playing with the good lane, ADC,
you won't lose the lane, but you won't win it. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
You either go even or you kind of win it, but that's because like your ADC is good. That's why like the worst elo to be in is anything under diamond four. When it comes to AD carries, they're all mechanically bad. Most of them are like even boosted. Like I had a guy like he swallowed so many skills. Like I'm hungry and I'm eating pizza. Like he swallowed as many pizzas as I can dish out right about now. Jesus Christ, I hated it. Like. I see, like, every little mistake is punished by him. Like it was punished, and it's just, like, you don't deserve to be in this level of play if you don't play at this level of play. Like, yeah, you have an expectation of Diamond. There are mechanics and game knowledge. You have an expectation of that. If you don't have mechanics or game knowledge, then, like, you can't really... There's no possible... Like, you might have your on and off moments, but this is, like, this isn't even an off moment. You're just straight up boosted. I checked the guy's OPGG. It's fucking... Plat 5 for a bunch of seasons in a row, then suddenly he's Diamond 4. Like, okay. Like, sure, dude. I totally believe that. There's no fucking way. Then suddenly I check his, like, MMR rating, and it's just like, a sudden skyrocket in ELO, because you've been Plat 5 for literally years. Very, wow. Very, very, very interesting. You are something else. That's all I said. It's so bad. Like, my God. But you can't be one to judge that in any if you are the elo that you are, whereas I'm higher than where I should be. Like, you know what I mean? Like, if I'm D1 and I'm playing in Diamond 4, this should be easy. But like, I shouldn't be picking Janna because I'm solely relying on my team. It's just I'm picking Janna as a defensive mechanism in order to prevent the other team from picking Janna. But you, for the most part, your confidence is like in the laning phase. No matter what kind of support you're playing it too defensively. But then again, like I do see your aggression, but you're playing a lot of it defensively. Whereas like there's so many opportunities for you to be very, very aggressive.
Right.
This is gonna be a long ass session because like the game was 40 minutes. It's like almost 2 hours of just talking. But that's fine. a lot of it, like it, the thing with Karma is like that's actually a solo carry lane. Besides the fact that you could do, you know, one dimensional, two dimensional stuff, right? You can protect and you can aggress. Yeah. So. Morgana is the same thing. You can protect and you can aggress. She's two-dimensional because she can initiate in the front line, but also use her ultimate as a form of peel. Because if they get on her, if they get on your AD carry or some shit, you just ult them, they're slowed, and then they get stunned. If they stay in range, then your AD carry shoots them while they're running away from your ultimate.
So I think the reason why I can't play Morgana is because I always forget to use the hourglass.
Oh, if it's just the hourglass, it shouldn't be a big deal. You know, I don't even buy I rarely even buy hourglass. Like, I don't even rush it, man.
Everyone uses that on her, so
yeah, exactly.
I just assume
I don't buy it first. I buy it last because I'm busy buying redemption and locket. Because I value utility. I'm still a utility champion too, remember? So I value that.
Yeah.
Yeah, you have to see what value is in like what it means, like what it comes to priority and distribution of gold and skill. And mana and stuff like that. So that's why I'm saying, that's what I mean by value, by the way. If you think of like the word is confused, like what do you define as value? Like I value like Ruby Sightstone, or I'm sorry, I value Ruby Sightstone and Frost Queens or Talisman over Eye of the Items, except on certain champions like Zyra and Karma, who are very aggressive and need money on damage items because they actually deal damage and can carry. That kind of thing.
Right.
Morgana, however, doesn't need the damage to carry. She's a CC bot. So therefore, I don't value Eye of the Watchers on her. But sometimes if I'm behind, or even, I'll value Eye of the Watchers on her because I value Zhonya's on myself because of the way their team comp is structured. Everything changes according to the situation. You just have to recognize which situation comes up first. And that's really important. It's like, team composition-wise, Nautilus was, like, it's kind of, okay, so if you pick Janna here, right, you can peel and stuff, but you'll struggle in lane. Like, Vel'Koz was dicking on you. Like, you notice how many times Vel'Koz was able to step out of position, but then you just punished him, right? Because that's because you were Nautilus. If you were Blitz, it would be a little bit of a different deal. Because, like, you have a higher likelihood of missing, you know? But, like, with Nautilus, like, do you feel that the pick was, like, was good into their team comp? You notice that you stopped all engages. You notice that, like, you stopped all engages. You initiated. You hooked. You caught people out of position. You had bundles of CC. It was the most, like, optimal pick at that time. Because of their team comp. And the way your team comp required a tank. Had you picked Blitzcrank, you would be pulling stuff, that's great, but you don't want to pull the Renekton into your team comp because you saw what Renekton could do to your misfortune, right?
Yeah, there's not much like peel. Like Nautilus is a great peeling tool.
Yes, exactly.
Like with Blitz, there's you can't really do anything but knock up real
exactly.
quick.
Yeah. I was like, this guy's something else. That was hilarious. Like she just straight up instantly died. I was like, you know, she's when you said why doesn't she like go back? And I thought you meant like go back in, and I was like, no. You want her to run the fuck away. Also, you don't abuse your auto attack as much, though your attack speed might be slow. Oh yeah, I need to show you the rune page, for Nautilus. Let me spectate a game to break this thing. So it's fine if we just do two games and then just like a long verbal session, because that makes up for the 3 hours, right? That's cool too.
Yeah.
All right. Give me a sec. Press Alt F4 on this, and then it should quit. Kiritsugu. Damn, he's playing with Kirit. This guy hit Challenger at the beginning, and then he got decayed, because then, like, the real Challenger started showing up, and then, like, that's a problem. Because, like, if you hit Challenger at the beginning... You know Pink Ward, right? Pink Ward?
Huh?
You know Pink Ward?
Oh, no, actually. I don't know. Is that...
Pink Ward is a... He's a Shaco player.
Okay.
Hold up, lag. Okay. He's a
Shaco. I was about to be like... I had no idea. I was like, it's a control ward now.
No. He's a player. His name is Pink Ward.
Yeah.
Holy okay. shit. He hit Challenger at the beginning of the season. When I had to play against him, he hit Masters. Or he was at Masters, 0 LP. If he lost the game, he would get demoted. He lost the game because I shit on him. He got demoted to D150 LP. I was like, XD. I'm sorry.
That's mean.
Okay, so here's the Thresh room. I have... 8 rune pages for support because I like played all in rank, then I have roles for other things, like, you know,
yeah,
matches series is about, look at this, like, and then it's just straight win and easy diamond, and then after that I just go on tilt because like aids, winning more than losing is more important. But anyway, this is the page for Nautilus. Armor like Quince armor, Mark's armor, health to make efficient use of your armor, because health is nothing without armor, and armor is nothing without health or resistances, and the flat magic resist. I don't value mana regen unless I have a mage support that really really needs the mana regen, such as I have the Janna, Lulu, Karma, Nami, why do I have a second L, Bard, Annie, why do I have a second L, seriously, there's only one L support, right? Lux maybe, I don't even fucking know. But
Leona's not a mage.
I don't know why I have a second L, but like I just have JL and Mia. That's going away. The fuck. But like all my mage supports, I value a little bit of mana regen on them, so I take it. Otherwise, right. I don't. I have Malzahar Page. I don't value mana regen on him. I don't value mana regen on Janna because I shouldn't be expending that much mana. And then Soraka, you do need the mana because you need the health just as well. I value Zyra for damage, and then I value Leona just full tank. Full tank. See? Pretty much straightforward rune page. You need flat health seals. They are the extremely expensive ones. You know, 820 each one. 7,300 total. Insane amount of cost. But they're the most useful.
Yeah.
Otherwise, you just run all armor and magic resistance. That's it. Like, no scaling. Yeah. Remember, flat health and traits. I explained that before. And then after that, I just have like other rune pages like Kha'Zix and stuff like that. And stuff
that I literally just started getting into runes like 2 weeks ago, because all these years I've been playing this game, I was just too impatient to get runes. Like, it was kind of like a chore. Like, ugh, really?
Yeah.
Yep. Like, I'd rather just get champions and learn all these cool champions.
Yeah.
So I never got runes until now. I was like, you know what? I think it would be beneficial, instead of like putting money towards like skins and like buying champions.
Oh yeah, the only time I get skins are from these fucking chests, dude. I don't give a shit anymore, man. You get free skins like that. Fuck yeah.
Definitely. So I actually just decided to go ham, and I got the whatever it is, the rune page pack, and I bought like a bunch of IP boosts just so I could grind games for
good.
Like
good choice.
Just to get runes.
Very good choice.
That's what I've been doing.
Yeah, that's a pretty good idea.
Because I have all the champions that I ever need now. I mean, I don't really want anyone else. I have all the supports and all the mages. So
if I had it, I can play. If I'm obviously with the duo, I can easily play any like support only based accounts. Like that's just how it works. Because I just know how to do it. And then if you want to do a cheese support, you can also pick up Brand because he's really easy. Like to just light people up on fire. Like everybody hates Brand because he's just fucking broken as shit.
Yeah.
I hate his base damage. This is why is he allowed to like deal so much fucking damage for like no reason? But it's like no big deal. Your goal is just to avoid him, avoid fighting him at all costs. That's like the most important tip about playing against a Brand. No matter what support you play, his goal is to punish you while you're CSing, and that's what you should be doing. I noticed you don't do that on Janna, but like it doesn't mean as much because like they had a Zyra, so you shouldn't be doing it in general. But basically, whenever they try to CS, just whack them. Like it's a very straightforward mechanic. Like you just throw your Q-tip at them or whatever the name of the item is, or your cotton swab, because that's what it looks like. But you just throw whatever it is at them, because then they can't really like respond because they're busy right-clicking the minion. They won't right-click you. But you just have to be careful of the support retaliation, therefore like causing a lot more problems than you intended.
Man. Yeah. Oh, I mean, you know what? The funnest champion to go against with Janna is Leona. It's so fun. It's so easy. I mean, for me at least, maybe it's because they're all bad. Like, I just happen to be up against bad Leonas, but it's so easy to deny, was it her E?
Yeah. Her gap closer.
Yeah, it's so, I mean, a few times, like, you can see her, like, walking up all ambitious, like, and I just start the queue and wait for her to use it. And then just deny it. And then it's an easy poke lane. I just get my brain's dying. I forgot what it's called.
No, it happens, yeah.
The poke item in the beginning of the game.
You get money off of that, yep.
Yeah.
She's really fun abuse, yeah. Aside from that, Alistar's also a pretty good one too.
Yeah, I was thinking about that. Man, I'm indecisive in everything that I do. Like, I'm trying to find a champion that I could just get really good at that can win me games. Like, I think Alistar might work because I can get those cool flash, pulverize.
Oh, no. You want to play a champion that limits room for error. Meaning, like you can make mistakes and still be okay with it. Alistar, you can't. You need those WQs to land.
Oh.
So, a champion that I cannot play is Bard.
Yeah, no, I don't. I'm not even gonna bother playing
Tom
Bard.
Tom Kench. I went 0-14 my first game. Won because I ended up with 4-16 because he's broken. Like he's literally. I meant 4-16-39, but I mean like he's broken as shit.
Yeah. So. Yeah, I'm just not used to playing
that game. Though it was funny as fuck. I was getting flamed. I was like, "Yo, dude, you're going 0-16." Tom Kench 0-16. So it would just have to be you practicing Karma Morgana. I would advise most for those two. Karma Morgana.
Yeah, it'll probably be Karma because I used to play her a lot a while back.
Yeah.
So I'm more comfortable with her. It's just I'm not used to playing like poke reliant mage support, so it'll just be a new. Play style to get used to, I guess.
You abuse positioning. Also, Karma can hit people when they're standing behind the backline, simply because you hit the backline, but then the impact of the explosion hits them too. Therefore, you take Spelthies and you get free gold for smacking them in the face. Do not press Empowered Q to poke, because that hurts a lot. It hurts for poke, but like if you hit the minions with it, you might push the wave in a disadvantageous manner.
Oh. Really?
What she can teach is that because she can teach you how to change up your aggression. Basically, because you're pushing so much, because you're always poking and shit, you can also defend yourself. Like, oh, I'm getting ganked, by the way. If you know how to deal with it, it's good. I always push when I'm playing Karma, unless I'm up against a non-favorable matchup. And then if I get ganked, I just RE out of there. Most of the team fights involve around you playing around your RE. Never RQ during a team fight ever. If you ever do it, you're losing the potential of your abilities. RE yourself.
Yeah. I never knew that.
That's literally a Locket Talisman. Like, I don't realize like how valuable it was to Locket Talisman, but it's a Locket Talisman. Like, holy shit.
So yeah, I never really knew that. I kind of just abused the RQ, especially in lane when I used to play her.
Yeah,
so,
RQ in lane, but RE in team fights. You put 3 points in Q at level 1, 2, say level 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. It's Q, E, Q, or Q, E, W, Q, Q. Level 6, your level R. 7 through 9, just max your E, then max your Q. Like, you put 3 points for the lane and sustain. After that, you poke.
Oh. Wow, okay. So, yeah, that's the only thing I have to really get used to, because when you play Karma, you have, like, 6 different options. Like,
never
you
max
have
W.
Your R.
never max W first.
Do you ever even use W with
yes.
your R ever?
Yes. When I need to sustain myself, like when I'm making clutch plays under tower. Like, legitimately serious, You press RW under tower and then you heal up a little bit, and if they stand under tower and continue to fight you, you heal up again, then they're snared and it's hilarious. Otherwise, it's very rare. Like, the likelihood, I'll use RE over RQ over RW most of the time. Like, RQ is only because I use it in lane. But RW is like very, 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 very rare. We're talking like secret rare, kind of rare. Like, I don't know if you understood the Yu-Gi-Oh reference. No, like that's a terrible reference. Like, fucking once in every 1,000 years kind of rare thing. It's very fucking rare. But I would just straight up never use it, like, at all. Unless you're like top lane or something like that. I have the pink skin. Yeah, it's a really fun champion.
So yeah, man. Karma is fun, but you know what's weird? I never see any good Karmas. Is that common? Every time I go up against a Karma, they're always shit.
Really? Like, see Karmas, like, dicking on me in lane half the time. That's because I was up against Biofrost one time, and that was like, oh, shit. That was actually some shit.
Yeah.
Like, that was actually some actual shit. I was like, oh my god, fuck. And he used spells in a really weird manner. Again, creativity with their spells. Like, he would use W to lock me down, then RQ me to, like, hit me while I'm snared so I can't dodge the RQ. Or he would RQ me as I'm running away so that as soon as I get snared, I'll get hit by both procs instead of just one half of the proc.
Yeah.
Or he'll use his RE to catch up to me, and then he'll flash W me, so I have to flash, but then I still get locked down by it because he's moving so fucking fast. So, like, there's a lot of creativities of the ways you use your spells. So that's another thing. You can develop, like, a sense of, like, creativity with it, too. It's really fun.
All right.
Okay.
Yeah, I guess I'll just grind games. Like,
yeah, that's another important thing. You can't just, like, get good at the game without actually, like, playing a lot of games in order to develop a game sense. Like, you can't just, like, okay, one coaching session, now I'm instantly better. Like, this, you put these these philosophical thoughts into practice. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So, like, with that being said, I can close out the session now, and it's going to be a few days before it uploads, because I have because due to my blue screening, like, consistent blue screening, I'm behind on schedule. This is going to be the second video is going to be significantly longer than the first one. We're talking, like, almost two hours long. Like, that's, like, a fucking intense.
Oh.
Yeah, because I didn't stop for the verbal, but, like, that didn't matter, because the verbal was chained on with the secondary session of me reviewing the game, which is fine. I'm not against that. It's just my viewers are going to be like, the fuck is this two-hour video? And then it's, like, it's hilarious. But if they actually do listen to it all, then, yeah. You can also, like, just, like, feel free to message me back, like, whenever you feel like you're making some progress, like, check this out, check my match history, blah, blah, blah. And stuff like that, because it's pretty straightforward. I mean, like, I always get back with my clients, and then if you want to order more, you just let me know, because then I could just sit back and say, like, okay, what's your progress? Have you done some of the habits I've asked you to do? Refillable pot, more control wards, management of lane. Let's see what you're doing. And then just check on progress. Like, good, you're making progress. Oh, I see what you did wrong here. This was a decision making.
Yeah,
it's
definitely.
It's just repeat coaching, but then you don't order it, like, immediately, like, a week after. Like, you order it, like, people order it, like, 2 weeks, 3 weeks down the line, because then that gives them a lot more time to work with it too. So, you know, like, just check back with me, ask me questions. I'll be available to answer them whenever I can.
Okay.
Because you know, I'm active on Skype. It's just that, like, recently there's a Skype bug, like, where like the contact requests and some of the messages, they just don't go through. You know, like, so that's it was terrible.
Okay,
like, it took
me
so long because I saw your message on my phone, but I can't respond to it because the Skype was just bugged. I could not respond to it. I was like, oh my god, I'm just gonna have to wait till it shows up. Then at night, like, hours later, it showed up, and I was like, okay.
Oh, wow. So real quick, I just want to, like, get this drilled into my head. I want to just, you know, basically, the best thing for me to do, obviously, grinding Karma in normals, watch YouTube videos, just find all the different, you know, learn her ins and outs. try to, you know, use her in ranked, and basically never really play Jenna anymore unless it's like obvious. Like if I go against the Leona, I'm probably gonna pick Jenna into her just because
you feel comfortable. I find it, definitely.
Yeah. So if I just kind of forget about Jenna, because I'm always so hesitant to play anything besides her. Like when I see an opportunity to like play Nautilus, like I'll be like, man, I want to play Nautilus, but
did you feel like
I'm
playing
so much
Jenna?
Better at
did
Jenna.
You feel like playing Jenna when I told you to play Nautilus?
No, actually, to be honest, I felt like playing Sona because
of the Vel'Koz poke.
Yeah.
Right. So what do you think about? Okay, so what did you think about the Nautilus choice?
Okay, it was better than I thought.
See?
Yeah.
So, I never told you about rock, paper. I was actually supposed to explain to you rock, paper, scissors. Hard engage is poke beats. Okay. Sustain beats poke. Hard engage beats. Okay, hold on. It should be pick, poke, hard engage. Pick beats poke, poke beats. Oh, no. Hard engage beats poke, poke beats pick. Pick beats hard engage.
Wait.
There we go.
Hang on. So, I heard of something like that, but I thought it was different. I thought that... Say it again, like slow.
Hard engage beats poke. Poke beats pick. Oh. Pick beats
what's
hard
pick?
Engage. Huh?
Pick as in like Blitzcrank? Like
pick,
when you
pick is
out...
like Blitzcrank. Pick is like Evelynn. Pick is like Shaco. Those that can pick targets off like one by one and force a 4v numbers advantage based team fight.
Yeah.
But like in the sense that they're weak as a 5-man unit, but they're stronger as like a 5 or a numbers unit.
I always thought it was when like, I say kill, I just mean like kill lanes in general, so like Thresh, Blitzcrank, Nautilus.
Those are pick based champions. Like they pick people off.
Okay.
Yeah.
I thought, okay, pick or I always called it just like kill lane, beats.
No, kill lane. You want it to kill lane? That's Jarvan Pantheon bot lane, man. Or Jarvan Leona, that kind of thing.
Oh.
That's a kill lane, sir.
So, man, I'm trying to...
Cheesy slaughter lanes? Like, yeah,
basically,
that's a fucking...
Hard engage lanes, I guess. I really don't know. Fine. Pick. Beats. I always thought that pick beats sustain because, like, let's say you see a Soraka.
Yeah.
She's freaking.
Pick,
as
pick
going
actually
as crap,
does a lot
but
more.
If you can...
Pick does a lot. Like, yeah. Champion select is kind of hard to tell, but the thing that I chose you to take Nautilus is because all he's reliant on is poke and look how immobile he is. All you have to do is just catch him when he's out of position and then you kill him, then making the lane a 2v1. Therefore, if you win lane as a 2v1, especially when MF has a lot of burst damage and consistent damage because she's going ADC and not support. You basically win the lane because of the Nautilus pick. Now you just have to execute the lane winning procedures, which you did. So from that point, it's just macro, long-term decision making. And then that's a little bit where the problem started. Your Lee Sin's kind of retarded, like really retarded. Your Yasuo is kind of YOLO, but does save the game. So I'll admire him for that. Like, you get the idea, right?
Yeah, I just honestly, if that ever happened again, I assure you 100% that I'm not going to... Yeah, I'm not going to think about Nautilus because in my head, I'm thinking, okay, sustain beats poke, and Vel'Koz is poke.
Yeah, sustain... Well, sustain doesn't beat poke. All it does is just mitigate the poke. But you're still going to get poked.
Yeah.
But what destroys the poke is that, like, okay, I keep getting stabbed. I'm just going to Band-Aid it. Nah, how about you just kill the person that stabbed you? Like, what about that? You ever consider killing the person that stabbed you so he stops stabbing you? Like, that's basically the short part. You keep getting bullied. Or you could do something about the bully. As obnoxious as that sounds, that's my mentality approaching it. I can keep dealing with it, or I can put an end to it. And I'd rather put an end to it. For example, if you had a Maokai in the top lane instead of a... What the fuck did you have top lane? Yasuo? I think Yasuo, right? I don't remember.
Yeah.
But if you had like a Maokai, for example, you get the idea, right? Like, that's another instance of like how to counter it too. Because then you just pick, because like if Ezreal's poking and then he gets caught and then he dies, well, half their damage output's gone. So, you know.
True.
Hard engage on them. Hard engage is like hard CC kind of damage dealers. Like they just lock them down, and then they destroy the opponents really fast.
Huh.
That's not really... There's a difference between pick and poke. Like, hard engage is like Wukong. Like Nautilus, because he has so much CC available to his dispensal, and he's tanky. You know what I mean? gold carding somebody with Twisted Fate, etc., etc. That's hard engage.
Okay.
So yeah.
Yeah. So I guess what I'm gonna do is.
You said grind games, yeah.
Grind games, but practice all the little things that you were talking about, mm-hmm. like ward placements, just like all the little decisions.
Yep.
And try my best to turn karma into like a one trick.
Yeah, that's like a good for me. And it, yes.
And once I do that, I'll probably message you again, like if once I'm comfortable.
You're gonna hit a wall. Every single player hits a wall. I hit a wall too. So that's where
what
the
do
question
you mean?
Is. Like you're gonna get comfortable with karma. Then you can either A, go into rank with her until you stop climbing. Cause you'll start winning a bunch or losing a bunch, but then you're gonna win a bunch. But then you'll be stuck at one elo where you can't climb. I was stuck in diamond 2, like I couldn't climb out of diamond 2. I had to figure out what I was doing wrong. Turns out I was camping in the wrong lanes. I didn't figure out how to camp. Turns out camping top was the best option. Started camping top more. Destroyed Ryan Troy, Rengar one trick that got the challenger in season 3, 4, and 5. Destroyed him. Got mad. Wow. Banned me on stream as a result of it. and it was just beautiful. Like I was like, my god, I could just abuse top lane. So I just kept spamming it, like, you know what I mean? Like I was camping the wrong lane. Should I camp mid lane?
Well, whenever I hit the wall, I'll probably
message me.
Do another session with you and have you review it or whatever.
Yeah. Sounds good.
Awesome.
Alright. So again, a few days and I will see you next time, man.
Yes, thank you so much.
Of course.
Bye.
Alright guys, thanks for watching. This has been Aloha Veggie for a very, very long multi-hour session. Thanks for watching my videos. Please follow me on Twitter at LOLVeggie, and you can follow my Skype for coaching too. I'll see you guys next time.